Satellite images reveal two warships were damaged following Ukraine's extensive attack on a Russian ship repair base in Crimea on Wednesday. Kyiv said the two vessels were likely beyond repair after the strike. Russia's defense ministry confirmed the attack, but insisted the vessels would be fully repaired. The strike was seen by military analysts as the biggest attack of the war on the port city of Sevastopol, the home of Russian Navy's Black Sea Fleet. Now, Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky also hailing what he describes the destruction of a Russian air defense system in Crimea. Russian forces seized the Crimean Peninsula from Ukraine and annexed it in 2014. The People's Bank of China again making a move to bolster the world's second largest economy. It announced that it would cut the reserve requirement ratio, or the amount of cash that banks must hold as reserve, by 25 basis points. This covers all banks except those that have implemented a 5% reserve ratio. This is the second cut of this year. Now, the Chinese government has rolled out a series of policy measures in recent months to support its stuttering economic recovery. The European Central Bank raises interest rates to a record high of 4% Thursday, but it signals this may be its final hike to tame stubborn inflation. This is the central bank's 10th straight rate increase, and Thursday's 25 basis point hike took the bank's deposits to the highest level since the euro was launched in 1999. The central bank also raised its forecasts for inflation, which it now expects to go down more slowly towards its 2% target. The annual inflation in the 20 countries that use the euro had been slowing until last month, when it remained stuck at 5.3% as energy costs rose. Meanwhile, ECB hints that further rate hikes may be off the table for now, prompted the euro to fall and European shares to rise. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, DJ Manoto.
Good morning, Nikki. Here are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipinos in the North America region. We begin with President Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden, being criminally charged on Thursday after efforts to reach a plea deal had failed. This is the first ever prosecution of a sitting president's child. The indictment filed in U.S. District Court in Delaware charged 53-year-old Hunter Biden with three criminal counts related to making false statements in connection with the purchase of a firearm and illegally possessing the firearm as a drug addict. Meanwhile, Republicans in the U.S. House of Representatives have opened an impeachment inquiry into Democratic President Joe Biden after months of investigation of his son Hunter's foreign business dealings. Republicans have accused the older Biden of profiting from his son's business dealings while serving as vice president between 2009 and 2017. The White House calls the impeachment inquiry baseless.
You see Republicans in Congress, right? They have spent all year investigating the president. That's what they have spent all year doing. And have turned up with no evidence, none, that he did anything wrong.
President Biden also brushed off the House Republicans' impeachment inquiry, saying the way he sees it, they launched the investigation against him because they want to shut down the federal government. Speaker Kevin McCarthy has been struggling to get enough votes to fund the government and prevent a federal shutdown. Meanwhile, Las Vegas, which has the largest population of Hawaiians outside of Hawaii, is stepping up to help the devastated island of Maui. As Maui struggles to bounce back in the aftermath of the worst wildfire in modern U.S. history, Las Vegas residents, including Filipinos, are taking steps to extend much-needed help.
We sent food to the Maui Food Bank. We brought maybe 860 pounds of food.
Donated backpacks, canned goods, toiletries, and baby diapers are also being shipped to the hardest-hit town of Lahaina. The Philippine Chamber of Commerce of Southern Nevada continues to welcome donations for the victims of the Maui wildfire. For those who wish to help, may call 702-460-1646. And finally, will Ana de Guzman become the first female magician to win America's Got Talent? Well, she certainly has a shot, and she has advanced to the finals.
Howie, is that your one-of-a-kind card that you just signed?
Can go ahead,
show everybody. Is it really?
Oh my God, this is it!
Is it?
Howie with a star! Look at that! The star!
24-year-old Filipina Ana de Guzman from New Jersey stunned all four AGT judges with her card trick during her live performance show as she masterfully located their missing playing cards by catching them mid-air, spitting them out of her mouth, or pulling them from a cake.
We need more female magicians. That's all I can say.
Besides De Guzman, fellow Filipino Shadow Ace also got to perform at the recent live show. The shadow puppet specialist from the Philippines said he grew up in a house without electricity and turned to this art to entertain himself. You. A third Filipino, Roland Abante, a fisherman from the Philippines, also impressed the judges at the same live show with his rendition of I Will Always Love You. Among the three Filipino contenders, only De Guzman got enough votes to advance to the finals of AGT.
Thank you, Howie.
And those are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community. For more of our TFC News, log on to our website, news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews. Check in on our ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app on your smartphones and tablets. Back to Nikki for the rundown.
The Philippine Central Bank not keen on implementing an interest hike despite a recent spike in headline inflation. This comes as the consumer price index in the country rose to 5.3% in August, buoyed by a hike in food and fuel prices. Now, for Philippine Central Bank Governor Eli Ramolona, the situation does not warrant a rate hike.
We've been hit by what we call supply shocks, but these kinds of supply shocks, they dissipate usually fairly quickly. So if that's all there is, if there are no further supply shocks beyond that uptick in August, then it won't be necessary to hike the policy rate.
Ramolona wants inflation to reach government's target range of 2-4% before changing the central bank's policy rate, a target he believes could be reached as early as next month. The Monetary Board will hold its next policy meeting on September 21. A Philippine agriculture official disputes a U.S. government report which says the Philippines will soon surpass China as the world's top rice importer. The official says the report missed its mark. Vivian Gulia with the story.
The Philippines is projected to take over China as the world's top rice importer. That's according to the latest report of the United States Department of Agriculture, which estimated that the Philippines' rice imports will hit 3.9 million metric tons for trade year 2022-2023, while China's rice import volume is seen to decline to 3.5 million metric tons from 6.1 million metric tons last trade year. The USDA observed a delay in the Philippines' purchases this year as it awaits lower prices. The country is expected to continue being the top rice importer next year with a projected import volume of 3.8 million metric tons. The Federation of Free Farmers attributes this to the country's increasing rice demand, which is not met by local production.
Sa analysis namin before RTL, we were importing only about 10% of our requirement. Last year, it was already at 21%. Of our requirement in 1 year. Because we are becoming more reliant on imports, so we will have to be subjected to the price movements in the international market. Ang implication nun, the government programs are not succeeding in improving local production.
Group Mantay Bigas believes the growing rice imports is a result of the government's failure to improve local rice production. Agriculture Undersecretary Leocadio Sebastian, meanwhile, disputes the USDA's projection, saying the DA expects to import much less than the figure cited in the report for this year and the next, with intensified efforts to produce more rice locally. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who also heads the Agriculture Department on Wednesday, admitted the Philippines cannot be dependent on rice imports, adding that local production should be developed.
This is a lesson that we immediately learned. He said we cannot now continue to depend on importation, which is what has happened for the Philippines. In the past years, it became the easy way out.
Some farmers' groups expressed their opposition to reduce rice import tariffs and called for a thorough review before a decision is made.
Kung binaba mo yung tariff doon, wala naman assurance na ibaba ng importer yung presyo ng bigas dahil wala namang cap yung presyo nila.
Karamihan ng mga inaangkat nating bigas ay yung mga mamahaling grado that is sold to well-off consumers. If we bring down the tariff for those types of rice, hindi makikinabang yung mahihirap.
The distribution of subsidies to rice retailers continues with nearly 200 recipients in Manila on Thursday and less than 100 in Malabon. Some rice retailers say the 15,000 peso subsidy is not enough to cover their losses from the enforcement of the price cap on rice, but they are still grateful for the assistance.
Nasa 25,000 siguro. Ayaw naman din namin mahuli at maparusahan kasi saka parang pag-aano na rin, charity na rin sa tao.
The local governments of Manila and Malabon are studying the possibility of augmenting the national government subsidy if the period for the price cap drags longer. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine regulators allay fears of a possible sugar shortage in the country. The Sugar Regulatory Administration sees next year's domestic demand for sugar reaching up to 2.3 million metric tons. It gave the assurance of sufficient stocks, with more to come as the harvest season is underway. It says it's monitoring sugar production and how this might be affected by the El Nino phenomenon.
Last year po kasi, yung total production natin is 1.799 million metric tons. Sa ngayon po, we are estimating an increase to 1.85 million metric tons. Kaso po, yung nilagay po natin sa sugar order na there is a possibility na bababa po yung 1.85 million natin ng 10 to 15%, depending on the forecasted El Nino. Sa ngayon, okay pa tayo. Yung expected po na El Nino is November to January yata yung forecast ng PAGASA. So we will monitor the severity of this. And we will see if it will bring about a decrease on the estimated production.